Q&A Friday on the show. That means time to give way to the money questions you've sent our way. I'm Edric Mendoza, and this is On the Money. Joining us to answer your questions today is financial advisor Mark Fernandez, and of course, Melissa Hercule and Salve Duplito. Hello, ladies. Q&A Friday.
Hello. Yeah, exciting. Out of the heat into the studio.
That's right.
Love Q&A Friday.
Let's get going.
Okay, so first question comes from Clark, who asks, is it still wise to put money in the bank?
Yes, please answer.
I think that's a simple question. Uh-huh. You know, it's still wise to place money in the bank. Mm-hmm. Where will you place your emergency fund?
All right.
The question is for what purpose, right?
Yeah. For what purpose? So what purposes would a person put their money in the bank for?
I think the best place to, the bank is really for emergency funds. Mm-hmm. So beyond 3 to 6 months of monthly expense, it should be invested out of the bank.
Mm-hmm. Right. And you can't really invest unless you have money in the bank anyway, mm-hmm. right? So if you want to take advantage of financial instruments, you have to have money in a bank.
Yes. So though you don't need to liquidate your assets if in case you need money, right? Mm-hmm.
I think one of the bigger challenges in our country, in another episode we had, right, was actually putting people's money in the banks.
Yes.
Because we have, what is the statistic?
One out of four
put their money in savings of some sort, and 2 out of 3
save.
Have them in the bank.
One out of four save, so that could be save in their mattress or in a jar.
Exactly.
Out of that, those 1 out of 4, only 2 out of 3
put
have their money
in the
bank.
See, so I think the challenge for us is to put in the money in a bank and to actually save for our country at least. So rather than the fear of will the depositor start going.
Right.
That's what I think.
Put money in a bank.
Yeah, put your money in the bank for the right purpose, right?
But there's a risk also, okay? There's some risk also of putting your money in the bank, as well as the risk when you put it under your pillow. You know, somebody can come in and just get it
from
you, right?
The rats
can
eat.
Risk of putting your money in the bank also is inflation.
Mm. Yes, inflation
risk. And just letting it sit there, like there's
but
around
you'd have the same
five,
problem
3 trillion
of inflation if you put it under your mattress.
That's true.
Yes.
So
true.
Whether you put it in a bank or under your mattress, the risk is the same.
Right.
But it's taxed.
Yes, it is.
It's taxed and there's inflation. But I guess what I'm trying to say is, there has to be a strategy. Mm. You put your money in the bank for a certain purpose. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of Filipinos also put all of their money in the bank and forget about it, but they have loans.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They
and
want
they
the liquidity.
Yeah.
They don't have the they don't invest. They have liquidity, but they have loans. They just can't let go of that feeling that, you know, anytime I need 1 million pesos,
it's there sitting in the bank.
So that's your risk.
Yes.
You're letting go of a lot of growth also.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
So
yes.
the best
Definitely.
Thing to do, I suppose, is to put some money in the bank and the rest in investments
that's
so
yes.
that some of it, at
that's
least,
why we have
is
a rule,
growing
3 to 6 months.
3 to 6 months, right,
yes.
Well, for the
what's
emergency fund.
What's a better strategy for taking care of that emergency fund in the bank? Is there a ladderized approach or... What do you do so that you put it in the bank, but it also earns money?
Hmm. Well, you have to, I guess it depends on how much cash you have, no? But I guess you have to slowly, when you're really starting up out in your job, you have to slowly add up some funds in your bank. Mm-hmm. And then if it goes beyond the 500,000 PDIC, you have to find another bank. Yeah, it depends on how much your expense is, right?
Okay.
Now, Leaf has a question, and he asks, I just started working 2 months ago. My monthly savings is around 12,000 pesos.
That's
any
great.
Advice on how I should wisely spend my income? As of now, I have not yet established an emergency fund.
Hmm.
2 months in the job, and she has 12,000.
That's what I'm saying.
Good job.
Yeah.
Wow, that's a high-paying job.
Yeah. So. Or she knows how to save well.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Or,
it's not about how much you make.
Okay,
right?
So what do you suggest?
Yeah. Well,
He
said he doesn't have any emergency fund yet.
So first,
back to the basics, emergency fund, 3 to 6 months. Mm-hmm. Protection fund, and then start investing.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess that's just the basics, right?
So come up with the amount of money that you spend on a monthly basis, and then come up with an emergency fund equal to up to 6 times that amount.
Yes.
All right. And then, but do you have specific tips on what he, for example, what he can do with the salary that he gets? Mm-hmm. Let's assume that he gets
He has the emergency fund.
What? Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
So let's assume he gets 20,000 a month. Okay, so what does he do with that? How can he increase his savings faster.
20,000 a month. So.
And he spends maybe 5,000 for food and lodging.
So the 20,000 nets 12,000.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so what we're going to do is to increase the savings.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when you increase the savings, you have to lower down the expense, right?
All
so
right.
I think the best way is to look at your expenses mm-hmm. and then see which of these expenses you can cut down, right?
All right.
So you can add more to your savings fund, yeah. Because that's a big amount that he has, no? And sometimes when you're single, you tend to spend.
Yeah. Was it easy for you to save when you were single in your first job?
Yes and no.
Why?
Yes, because I'm Ilocano.
How about you, Mel? Was it easy for you to save on your first job?
First
time to get your paycheck?
Yes and no. I mean, I was terrible. You know, I just felt like, yeah, it's all play money.
Yeah. That's
terrible,
true.
Terrible.
It's really hard to save when you're
right.
starting out.
But I was very good at paying off my credit card, always.
No loans.
But it's nice to see people this young and very, very aware of the need to save money. She has 12,000 and all you need to do is just do what you're doing now and just keep on saving.
Yeah.
Yes. Build the emergency fund first, as you were saying, right?
Yeah.
Put that aside already. Wow.
Okay, the next question comes from Lucia, who asks, I have dollar savings from the time a dollar was equivalent to 50 pesos. What is the best thing for me to do since the exchange rate may continue to favor the peso? Hmm.
Yeah.
Mark, your thoughts?
We have this thing that we call unrealized gain, realized gain. So the question there is, do you need the money now?
Mm-hmm.
So if this person, Lucia, needs the money now, I think
The no-brainer.
Yeah.
But
She has to bite the bullet and get the loss.
Realize the loss.
Yes. But if she has another source of fund, then she can always just leave it there. And, you know, it's just unrealized loss, right?
Mm-hmm.
So just wait for a few more years. Mm-hmm. And because we were told that we don't see anything to replace the dollar because the US dollar is still the most preferred currency when you go outside the country. It's the most preferred, and when you exchange it in the money changers outside the country, they still want US dollars, right? So we don't see anything that would replace the US dollars yet. So maybe that's just a temporary decline, and maybe it might in the future it can go
so down. Save it, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Keep
just want to clarify that. So let's say Lucia is going to the States in the next few months, and if she, of course, then she would need dollars. And so if she doesn't exchange it now and then she spends her dollars, she actually has not realized any losses.
That's right. Mm. As long as she's spending in dollars, she's fine.
No problem. But if she's going to spend in pesos, then I have to bite the bullet. That's 10 pesos for every dollar. That's
so as long as there's no conversion,
savings, right?
She's fine.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But if there is a conversion, then think about
she'll
it.
She'll feel the sting. So just keep it in savings.
Okay.
Right?
Now James asks, I'll be working abroad this year. I want my hard-earned money to earn as I earn. Do you have suggestions for me? I'm thinking of mutual funds and UITFs.
Working abroad this year.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think the best way to start, since you're focused on starting your job right, I think you can't go for active trading in the stock market. So I guess a pooled fund is the best way to start your investment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and so I guess you have to think of the pooled funds, or you can consider VULs, if this guy has dependents, I think you can consider VULs for an additional insurance coverage.
Or a term insurance plus a mutual fund or UITF.
Yeah, that's another possibility.
And what about exchange-traded funds? Because those are coming on to the market soon.
Exchange-traded funds. Well, there's not much news yet about exchange-traded funds, and so far we don't have any history to say whether the exchange-traded fund is really a good investment or not.
Right.
Unlike equity funds, we know we can say that for the past few years it's been earning this much. So I think we have to monitor first what's the exchange-traded fund going to be.
Do you think it would also help James to actually set a budget, since he's going to have a very different lifestyle now, so he knows exactly how much he has to work with in terms of investing, right? Wouldn't that be maybe step one for him?
Yeah, yes. Mm-hmm. Well, we've heard a lot of stories of OFWs coming back.
Exactly.
With nothing. So
and having to work like forever.
OFWs.
Take everything,
OFWs should consider the fact that their work is not permanent there, but they should set a goal as to when they want to go back.
That's right.
And that they must set an amount that they must need to have so that they can go back.
target because, that amount.
Yes, so that's, I mean, OFW should think that way, that mm-hmm. it's not a permanent job. They have to go back.
Yes.
And they have to set a target amount that when they have it, they can go back.
I think just having that target is life-changing,
yeah.
you know?
That's a good
it
start.
It helps you. Mm.
We're going to have more questions in a bit, guys. In the meantime, we'll continue to answer your questions when we get back, so stay with us. On the Money, we'll be right back. Welcome back to On The Money. Still with us to answer your money questions is financial advisor Mark Fernandez and of course our ladies Melissa Hecolea and Save Duplito. All right, lots of engaging discussions today. Let's
yes.
go to round two,
and
Mel.
More.
Okay. Yeah, let's go.
Athena emailed us and asks, I'm 28 years old and single. I have a house and lot, $250K in savings, $75K invested in UITFs, and I have two life insurances plus one medical insurance. My problem is I don't have a job at the moment, so I'm thinking of going abroad to work. Is it advisable for me to go overseas given my money situation? Do I need to continue paying for all three insurance policies?
Maybe you should get the last question first.
Mm. What is the most important consideration for her?
Mm-hmm. Well,
no job.
That's good that he has a emergency fund, so that $250K can really sustain him for the coming months. With regards to the life insurance, he can actually
she can continue to pay
for it. Uh-huh. But if it's gonna drain all the emergency fund, then I think he can somehow talk to the insurance company and ask for ways to somehow, like, what can I do with this? Can mm-hmm. I switch to quarterly mode of payment mm-hmm. instead mm-hmm. of an annual payment?
Manage cash flow. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So while I'm still looking for my job, and those things, and you can actually reinstate your policy if it does not go beyond 3 years. So,
oh, good.
So it's possible that you can actually stop paying
first,
and then reinstate mm-hmm. after 3 years.
Yeah, not beyond three years. Because if it goes beyond 3 years, all the premiums will be forfeited for
I see.
Purpose.
I'm curious, why does she need two life insurance policies?
Mm. Let's ask us.
Well,
she's single.
Athena, yeah.
She's, you know, so maybe. What happens if she decides to do away with one of those? Mm. Mm-hmm. Does she get money back or?
Depends, I guess, on the policy.
Mm. Well, there are many reasons why you get an insurance policy. It could be for your parents who are nearing retirement mm-hmm. and they are depending on you. So we never know. No? So if we were told that you should, as much as possible, keep your life insurance because you bought it at a discount. So if you terminate it and then get another one, then you're not buying it at the discount mm-hmm. anymore. So you're buying it at your current mm-hmm. age, and plus you don't need your medical condition
right.
at the time you apply for another insurance
right.
policy.
Okay.
Do insurance companies here cover anybody, an OFW, for example, who's working abroad and who gets sick or dies even?
Yes.
Yes, they're covered anywhere in the world.
There are some exclusions to which countries that we could cover,
mm-hmm.
But generally those countries that are
included
yeah. in the list. Well, I think we should think how much will be the expense if you're gonna apply abroad. I mean, mm-hmm. given you have this mm-hmm. amount of cash only, of course there are many expenses that you're going to incur. So maybe you can check some jobs here first, mm-hmm. here in the Philippines, and mm-hmm. you know. Hmm.
The idea of where to work will actually depend on the kind of job. At what level? Because there are certain jobs that, you know, the industry is very small in the Philippines, and sometimes, you know, everybody's taken and you have to look for another company abroad just to get a job. So it actually, there's a lot of factors, but it's true what you said. It has to depend on how much money she needs so that she can get that job overseas.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure how a financial planner, if you're working
there are more
with
details,
her,
right?
There
you
are
need
more
to get more details.
Yes.
But assuming, what are the rules of thumb that you think she should take care of first of her financial house here, so that whether she goes abroad or she stays here, mm-hmm. her financial house will still be in order,
right?
Uh-huh.
Mm.
Okay.
Well, the emergency fund is really something that you can hold on to for the coming months.
Thank goodness she has that.
Yes. So. She has to really calculate the expenses mm-hmm. that she's going to spend for the, I know there are a lot of expenses there, mm-hmm. the agents, for mm-hmm. whatever. So I guess you have to consider that before you find, you really say, I'm mm-hmm. going to go for that mm-hmm. job. But there are sure. really jobs that require you to go out, like, for example, programming jobs mm-hmm. are more lucrative outside. Mm-hmm.
Engineering.
So, yeah, engineering. Yeah.
Sure. Okay, we have another question, and this comes from Melissa, who says, I have been married for 14 years and have 4 kids. We've been living with my parents since the beginning, allowing us enough time to save and invest. 2 years ago, we invested in a condo unit, and that is where 30% of our total assets are now. Just recently, my father gifted us with a lot to build our house. I'm now short on cash, so I'm considering taking a loan to construct a house. Is it wise to take a bank loan at a minimal interest rate versus selling my investments, which are earning more, or is it advisable to liquidate the condo unit at this time?
Interesting case.
Yeah, interesting case. Mm-hmm. Is it wise to take a bank loan where the interest rates are low or sell the investments which are earning more?
Just so she can build a house.
No, it's wise to take a bank loan, I think.
Yes, yes, of course. The excess earnings that you earn from your investments, that's you're going to forego that if you're going to sell your investments mm-hmm. and take the bank loan. Mm-hmm.
Right? And so she can take what she's earning in her investments to pay off the monthly amortization of that bank loan.
Yes, definitely. Mm-hmm. And the interest rates now are at all-time low. So I think it's really wise to get a loan. What do you think?
What I wanted to ask you is, I think corollary to that question is the condo unit. Let's factor that in. Mm. So assuming the condo unit is an asset making money for her also, but would be less than, for example, an amortization she could pull out from the bank, would you still advise her to pull out a loan in the bank? Or would you say sell the condo?
Well, the amortization is for the house. I think they are already paying for the amortization for the condo. Mm-hmm. And I think as of their cash flow, they can already sustain that mm-hmm. because they've been paying it for 2 years.
Okay.
So that the new expense there is the new amortization for mm-hmm. the house. Mm-hmm. So I think you have to consider the fact that you're earning more from your investments. And so you just keep your investments and take a loan. Mm-hmm. Right? And then you have to consider, is it if there's a someone's gonna rent the condo? So if there's someone's gonna rent the condo, then you may take out the loan on the house.
But if not,
I guess you need to stay on that condo first and mm-hmm. wait until.
Don't liquidate the condo and build the house. Instead, stay in the condo is what you're
saying. Yes, mm-hmm. yes.
Yeah, there's a lot you can do. It allows you a lot of flexibility to keep that property. Why remove that from the equation when it adds more staying there?
Yeah.
Than not.
Makes sense.
So easy answer is taking out a loan, taking advantage of the low interest rate scenario at this time so she can take advantage of the returns on her investments. Mm-hmm. But let me just throw a question in here. Does she need the house?
Yes.
Does she really need to build a house now? Because mm-hmm. the reason I'm asking this is a lot of people make a mistake of buying a house. Sometimes a house that's bigger than they need, mm-hmm. and the mm-hmm. cost of maintaining that house is really taking away from their investment money.
Mm-hmm. Totally. House is more expensive than a condo to live.
I guess for Melissa, I want you to figure out if you need that house now. Because it's still better to pay for the construction of a house with cash, of course, but if you need a house and make it into an asset that can help build your net worth.
Yeah. Well, you have to, like what you said, you have to consider you really need to build a house. Yeah. If not, then just stay if you really want.
Stay in the condo and wait for a better time. You have more cash to build your own house. Mm-hmm.
But whatever the case.
Don't pull out a loan just because the lot is there. That's what we're basically
saying.
Thank you, Eddie.
There you go, right?
Okay, next question comes from Rubes, who asks, I'm 30 years old, single, and I've been self-employed for 2 years now. I've been earning well for my regular clients. I already have an emergency fund and I've started saving for my retirement. I'm planning on starting investing in order to earn passive income. The options I'm looking at are investing in UITFs, mutual funds, or VULs. Which do you think is the best option for me? Which should I invest in first? I'm not considering stocks yet because I don't have time to monitor the market and I don't have experience in trading stocks.
Single. 30 years old, self-employed.
A voice of reason.
Yeah, he's really good, actually. Yeah. Very practical.
What is it? UITFs, mutual funds, VULs. Which one first? What's the priority?
Well,
And the goal is for retirement. Am I right? Are we understanding the case correctly?
30 years old.
That's 30 years more.
Well, I did some math now. There are some investments. Well, VULs are good investments because I did some math. When you compare a mutual fund and a VUL, and you consider the loyalty bonus of the VUL, because VULs, when you invest for at least 10 years and you continually invest in that fund for 10 years, you get a loyalty bonus out of the fund, and it can be as much as 1% of the fund value. Mm-hmm. When you add it up until the 60th year and compare it with the same return of a mutual fund, you actually get a higher amount.
How much higher?
And what type of mutual fund?
Yes.
Equity?
Same. Or the balance or fund?
Oh, so same. Comparing it with the same apples to apples.
10% mutual fund growth, 10% VUL growth.
Because of the loyalty bonus,
yes,
I understand.
The VUL has a life insurance benefit the mutual fund does not have. But over the course of investing in the long run, the highest return goes to VUL because of the loyalty bonus.
It's 1% of the total face value?
The fund value. Right. The value of the fund.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. So, well, it depends. Sometimes it goes higher than 1%, it can be lower than 1%.
But Mark, when you put, let's do the same apples to apples figure. I put 100,000 in mutual fund or 100,000 in VUL. Mm. Not all of the 100,000 of the VUL goes to the mutual, the fund component.
The investment.
Right?
Yeah, yes.
Am I right?
Yes,
so whereas, if Rubes is looking at that, that has to be a factor that they look at as well.
Yes.
That the absolute amount I put in will not exactly achieve all of that return.
How would it compare if it was a term insurance plus a mutual fund compared to a VUL?
Well, I also did the math. Term insurance and mutual fund, there is no loyalty bonus in the term insurance and mutual fund. So if you really want to go and invest for the long term, the highest return goes to VUL. Mm-hmm. When you start early and you get the loyalty bonus, it's always in the VUL.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's assuming that she needs insurance, though. Yes. What if she's only looking for investments?
Yes,
which one should she use first? Mutual funds, UITFs, or VULs for purely investment?
For retirement.
For retirement.
Actually, you can still go for VUL because VUL has the highest return. Mm-hmm. When you calculate it until age 60 and calculate mutual funds for the same, let's say, 10% return at age 60, VUL still has the highest because of the loyalty bonus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mark, touch on the UITF. Just touch on that a little bit compared to the other two.
The UITF, almost the same as mutual funds.
Almost the same.
Yeah, so.
Okay. All right.
Okay. Interesting, because I always thought my concern about the VUL is that that money doesn't go into the investment portion right away. Mm. So the money you put in, so you can't take advantage now. If you start your VUL now, you can't take advantage of the market right now.
Exactly.
You can take advantage of the market later when it might not be so good.
Ten years later, like you were saying.
Yeah. It depends on when you enter it. Yes. Because the first time you're going to enter a VUL, some companies get 100% of your premiums and put it in insurance,
first.
Not in investment.
Yeah. Yes.
100.
Yes.
And then they might put the investment portion when the market's really bad.
But then again, if you are looking for the long term, that amount that was taken from you will be returned through the loyalty bonus.
Consider that, no?
Yes. Mm.
Consider that, yeah. Investigate before you invest. Right.
Okay, anyway, send us your money questions via email, Twitter, or Facebook, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
Yeah, and that's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again on Monday for more talk and tips so you're always right on time.